Hi, and thank you for joining me on Leaving Babylon. My name is Madeline. I'm really glad to have you here today. This session is going to be called Post Offices, The Big Deal. And the reason I called it that is because I started off asking the question, what is the big deal? What is the big deal of these offices, these big post offices of the old world style? Why did they have to be so big and ornate? And it just seemed like, you know, the kind of post offices we have now are nothing in comparison, architecturally speaking. So it's always been a big head scratcher for me, and I'm sure others have felt the same. So we can see here, this is actually the Boston. We're just going to start straight into it. This is the Boston post office back in the late 1800s. And it's just huge. And interestingly, it reminds me of some of the sort of more town hall style buildings that we also see, but bigger. So beautiful. And you can see the horses below. They're very small. The people are very small. It just gives you a scale of how big this is. And there's a little street trolley there. The roads look very kind of, I wouldn't say dirt roads exactly, but they don't look very well paved, which is always interesting to see when we look at these old buildings and then the roads are just kind of not all that great. It begs the question, how, according to the official storylines, did they build these with such poor roads? And then tiny horses, tiny carts, and things like that. This is the London Post Office, and again, it's just huge. Just the size of these buildings, the scale is just incredible. And you know, it's like, what were they doing in these big buildings? Like sorting envelopes. So you know, we think of mail as being envelopes, basically. And I think as we go through this session, we'll realize it's a lot more than that. The postal industry is huge, and we'll get more into some detail, which won't always be very comfortable. We'll see, though, how the post offices actually were used, and that role of the post was used to leverage a lot of money, a lot of power. And so, you know, when we start to see the scale of what's actually happening worldwide, that is, you know, it has its roots in the post office. And that's where we're going to go with this. So it does start to make sense why they would have these huge buildings. Cleveland Post Office, again, you know, for the Midwest, or actually northern states, I don't know, is that the Midwest? It's, you know, again, there's this dichotomy of what we're seeing. We're seeing people driving two-wheeled carriages, one horse, and it just doesn't match what we're seeing on the architecture. So I'm not going to talk too much more about architecture in this. We're going to go more about into the post office services, the postal services. This is, believe it or not, this was called the Post Office Tower in London. And it wasn't that old, actually. It was built in the 1900s, mid-1900s, actually. And it is now called the BT Tower, British Telecom Tower. So I believe there's offices down here, and there's kind of receiver radio. It's kind of a radio tower, actually. I believe there's a restaurant up here, like a revolving restaurant. So it's a little bit of a hail to the other kinds of towers we see, like the Sears Tower or the Space Needle in Seattle, those kinds of things. I think it's trying to be one of those, but it's just interesting that it was called the Post Office Tower. And you can just see it here in London. really, really, when they built it, it really looked out of place. I guess they were trying to be high tech, and who knows why else they picked that design. But it did remind me of a character called Doctor Who, which I've introduced before. And he has this sonic screwdriver he carries around. And in every series, it looks a little bit different. But it just does kind of remind me of the shape of that. And I do believe Doctor Who could be kind of another version of the Postmaster General, which is a very powerful position, actually, in the world, second to the President of the United States. And so, yeah, we'll get more into that. But I can't decide if Doctor Who is the Postmaster General for Earth in these science fiction series, or if he is Satan. Benjamin Franklin was the first Postmaster General of the United States. That role went way back to, I think it was the 1400s in England, but the United States didn't take that role on until they started the independence, the liberty, the freedom movement. And so, you know, I think just this Stamp Act and the protests that went with it and Benjamin Franklin's part in that was kind of all pointing to a similar component, which is what the colonies were after. And that was kind of like a liberty from the control of Britain, Great Britain. And essentially what we'll see is that the freedom that came with handling your own postage and your own shipping and trading and things like that actually brought a lot of commerce. So the ownership of that was really important, and I think that was one of the underlying desires of the independence movement. But as with anything, the Stamp Act was this tax that they really got people fired up about, because I'm finding as we look through history that one of the best places to poke the general masses is in their pocketbook. And if you can kind of make them afraid of losing their income in any way, if you can threaten the money that they have left over after they pay everything else, and you make them feel fear around that, you know, you're going to get riots, you're going to get protests. And I think they leverage that to really get the independence at that and a few other things to really get the independence movement off the ground and essentially successfully signed and all the colonies on board with that. So Benjamin Franklin was a massive player in all of this. And here we can see some of the propaganda that went along with it. So, you know, this is really, really, you know, they depicted a lot of gruesome things to show how destitute the colonies were feeling about things like taxes. And, you know, people see this stuff and they get really, it's evocative. And here we have sort of an emerging scene of what I would call merchant navy, shipping industry. So be like your shipping people. And there's a snake on the ground here. Why would a snake be kind of slithering around in this scene? Again, I am putting this under my The Loosing of Satan series, and I do believe that this all plays a part in the ultimate deception. So the snake is fitting. And we see a snake in other sort of depictions. This one is called the Gadsden flag, and it's basically "Don't tread on me." And it was really a revolving image around the, or a flag that came with the American Revolution. And we can just see here some different versions of that. "Don't tread on me," the Navy Jack, South Carolina. And then further down, I'm not going to try and pronounce that, but "Liberty or death, don't tread on me." And it just puts me in mind of that that curse that God put on the serpent when he said, "You will bruise his heel and he shall crush your head." So the seed of the woman will crush the head of the snake, and this just, it's like a very defensive pose that this snake is taking here. So I find that fitting for this. Kind of emerges out here too in the imagery. And here we have Benjamin Franklin schmoozing in France. He belonged to so many secret societies, and I believe his name actually comes from the Franks, the Frank line, the Frank bloodline, Franklin. I did a bit of looking into that, and it does seem that his predecessors, the spelling of their name is Frank, L-Y-N-E. And it does seem to go back. They kind of cut it off in the genealogies at a certain point where it says, oh, we don't know who this, the father of this predecessor was, but Franklin, or Frankline, is the name of that family. And the reason I'm bringing Benjamin Franklin back in is because he was the first Postmaster General of the United States. He also signed major, I think, four of the major independence documents. And he's just, as you all know, he is one of the pivotal individuals that was turning the crank for independence. Here he is in the courts of Louis XVI. Again, very connected to France, very connected to the liberty movements in France. And they were very aligned in their strategy against Britain. And as we know, the French were being driven by severe rebellion themselves, spiritual and political. So if you haven't watched my first two videos in this series, I do encourage you to do that. It shows there was a lot of spiritual rebellion going on. And here we have George Washington and Benjamin Franklin. I think these were the first postage stamps that the post office in the United States printed. And they've immortalized Benjamin Franklin in Paris. This is his statue there, being such a influential character across the sea on both sides of the liberty movements. So this man here is the first, I believe, the first postmaster that King Henry VIII put into that position. I think the position was created and he was given that role. And initially it was really to protect and carry the king's letters. And, you know, 100 pounds for the 1500s was a lot of money. And so they were paid very well for their services. And just highlighting this picture here. I really don't know why people draw things like this, but it does kind of give a sinister view of this individual. And it was not until, 1657 was when the head of the post office became known as Master of the Posts. So something, it's just the wording that I'm going to go with here for a minute. So Master of the Post became Postmaster General. So the title was actually Master of the Posts. And I found that intriguing because I did some looking up into... where did that title come from? Why did they use that title? Because if you have mail, or you have letters, or you have packages, you would. Where did post come from? It just kind of didn't make sense. But then I found that there is something called a post captain. So if we're going postmaster, post captain, which is a naval term. And it basically, they say it's obsolete, which is fine, but it was originally in the Royal Navy. And again, here it just says, commanders who received the title of captain as a courtesy, whether they currently had a commander or not. And then, you know, these fictional characters, master and commander or captain, this custom is now defunct. And it was just basically the alternative form of captain for the Royal Navy. And I think that was the point I just wanted to make there, because it links, for me, it links from the term postmaster over to maybe one of the reasons why they used the word post. If it was being used in the Navy, which is where they would potentially be shipping their letters. So head of the post office has been known by many different titles: master of the posts, comp general of the posts, and postmaster general as the head of the post office. And here we just see Brian Tuke was the master of posts. And so we're just building a foundation here of what is this person, when did it start, and we want to keep moving up into some more of the interesting conversations. Something's happening to my picture. Is that? So we're just going to keep moving in through some of this. Now, one thing I found is that Universal Postal Union is a very, very huge and important organization, which all countries are required to belong to. And this is where we start getting into the more large-scale connections between, you know, your local post office and maybe the entire world, okay? So the Universal Postal Union is a specialized agency of the United Nations that coordinates postal policies among member nations and facilitates a uniform worldwide postal system. So right here, we start to see this central control over everything that gets shipped, okay? So it comprises 192 member states, and the headquarters is in Switzerland, which I think, you know, maybe once we used to think of Switzerland as a sweet little chocolate-loving country, and maybe now we have some other views of that place. So the fact that it's based there isn't necessarily a comfort, but it actually makes sense when we start delving a little bit more into this. So the Universal Postal Union, the UPU, operated independently before being incorporated into the UN in 1948. They work on treaties, on a basis of treaties, so countries will have treaties with one another. U.S. Postmaster General, and we're going back to, I guess, 1853, doubted whether the arrangement could be safely continued, but he hoped a postal treaty with Bremen that also covered the Austro-German Postal Union. And then one important result of these treaties was that it was no longer necessary to affix postage stamps of countries that a mail piece passed through in transit. And so they established all of these laws. After the foundation of the United Nations, the UPU became a specialized agency of the UN in 1948. It is currently the third oldest intergovernmental organization after the Rhine Commission of the International Telecommunications Union. So it has its finger in both the mail delivery, postal delivery, and in telecommunications. And here we can just see from 2010, 275 million surplus in international mail. That was the United States Postal Service. It's huge business. And it's more than that. Here we go. In 2020, Trump advisor Peter Navarro declared that the agreement more than achieved the president's goal, but he denied that the United States was buying this deal with its contribution. UPU director Somasundaram hailed the agreement as a landmark decision for multilateralism and the union. So this, you know, this is something that presidents are very much involved in. This is not, as we'll see, as we keep going through, this is not just small potatoes. This is a big deal. Member states of the UPU include Vatican City and every UN member. So I started looking into about the UPU, and I like to do this. I like to go to the about link on pages that have to do with anything because I want to find out a little bit more about them. So we know that they are headquartered in Bern, Switzerland, and they have 192 member countries. They have a Congress, they have a Council of Administration, Postal Operations Council, and an International Bureau. So I'm just going to go through here. Actually, where I wanted to go was down here. So I wanted to look at who we work with. And I noticed that they have NGOs and foundations. And I think you can see there. So that, for me, is a huge red flag. The Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. To foster financial inclusion and develop inclusive access to financial services for underserved populations around the world. Because, you know, these mega billionaire elites really do care about the underserved populations around the world, I'm finding. All right, I was just looking at some of the nations that are involved in the UPU, and it gives you a date of entry. So here we go. We've got United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland joined. I don't know if that's January 7th or the 1st of July, 1875. And the United States joined on the exact same day. So that's just, it shows the, to me, it shows that, because I did look at some of the other countries as well, but it shows that on the surface for me, these countries are not as at war, because, you know, if you think about the whole reason for independence, it was that these countries didn't want to be connected. And yet they join all of the same organizations internationally, and they have treaties, and they have, you know, all of that. And then if we look at the UN international organizations that they belong to, we see UN Sustainable Development Goals, 2030 Agenda, the financial institutions, the trade facilitation and e-commerce. So these are plugged into everything. UN Habitat, they're plugged into every major international organization that rule the world and give them ultimate, you know, access to everything they need. I found this article, and I just found it pretty to the point. Someone just wrote it, and it's just a very short PDF, but it says, the UPU, the Universal Postal Union, is an extremely significant organization in today's world. It is formulated by treaty. No nation can be recognized as a nation without being an international admiralty. So remember that word, admiralty. In order to have a forum common to all nations for engaging in commerce and resolving disputes. And then it goes on to talk about the USA under the Articles of Confederation. It, you know, had to be recognized as a country. It had to join in order to be recognized as a country. And then it just kind of goes through and talks a little bit more about the terms of all this. So, if you post through the U.S. Post Office and the U.S. Postmaster does not provide you with, you know, remedy and all of this. So there's a lot of, unknowns that, you know, what people don't really know about the post office, I guess, is a way to say that. And now I'm going to play a little video because I like doing that just to keep everyone's attention. But no, this is, you know, I'm into my sci-fi, as you know, and I want to play a video clip from Men in Black, and then we'll just talk about it after.
People of Truro, Massachusetts, may I kindly have your attention? In order to facilitate your shipping needs, I'd like to remind you that all packages must be properly wrapped. This one is an example of go home and do it again. I think you know what I mean, Mrs. Vigushin. Brown paper and triple twist twine are the preferred media. Thank you for your time. Okay, C, express mail to there. Kevin.
Wow. Kevin, that's funny. You don't have like a Kevin. You don't remember me, but we used to work together.
I never worked in a funeral home. Is there something I can do for you, Slick?
Okay, straight to the point. You are a former agent of a top secret organization that monitors extraterrestrials on Earth. We're the Men in Black. We have a situation and we need your help.
There is a free mental health clinic at the corner of Lilac and East Valley. Next.
Excuse me.
Hey.
20 Rugrats stamps, please.
Elizabeth, the United States Postal Service hasn't quite kept up with today's youth, but I can't offer you some nice Berlin Airlift stamps.
No.
Opera Legends?
No.
American Samoa?
No.
Amish Quilts?
Sweetie, I'm sorry. Got a world to save here. There was no coma. It was all a cover.
Who are you?
Question is, who are you?
I'm the postmaster of Truro, Massachusetts, and I'm ordering you to leave these premises.
Okay.
Sandika? Sorry. All right, people, we have a breach. Beryl, cordon off this area. Billings, I'll have a full perimeter wipe down right here, right now.
Okay.
Beryl, get them off and escort all non-essential civilian personnel from this side immediately.
Yes, sir.
Listen to yourself, Kay.
Who talks like that?
Why do you think you're so comfortable here? Just about everybody works in a post office as an alien.
No smoking.
That town that they were in was called Truro, Massachusetts. And it just made me think, I wonder what goes on in Truro. And funnily enough, I found that they were talking about shipments. So he mentioned that the mail, the shipments have to get done and all of that. And just the fact that the town was full of people that weren't really from Earth or from there, and they were just kind of hidden in plain sight and all of that. So, but anyway, I did a little search on Truro, and I found that a very well-known shipping magnate is from there, and so this guy, called Edward Knight Collins, had a huge shipping company with his family. And so his name, Edward Knight Collins, and his father was Israel Gross Collins. And he had a large shipping company out of Truro, Massachusetts. I don't think they pick these things by accident in the movies. But in 1827, they started the first regularly scheduled packet service. And so, well, that all sounds very normal, right? Except that, we can see here that this little image here shows that the transatlantic shipping competition between Collins and UK shipping magnate Samuel Cunard here was curated. Got Uncle Sam on the left, and they're competing in a little boat race. I note there's an owl on this man's shoulder, so some symbology there. might be significant. But this term, packet service, if you go and look at that, packet trade, that sounds very benign, doesn't it? Packet trade is any regularly scheduled cargo, passenger, and mail trade conducted by boat or ship. Did you know that a passenger could be considered a packet? The boats or ships are called packet boats or packet ships, as their usual function was to carry mail. A packet service is a regular scheduled service carrying freight and passengers. The ships used for this service are called packet ships or packet boats. The seamen are called packet men, and the business is called packet trade. This sense became extended to mean any regularly scheduled ship carrying passengers. I have to emphasize that, as in packet trade. The word packet is frequently modified by the destination, i.e. Sydney packet, or by motive force, example, steam packet. And then they talk here about the history. So many states, civilizations, and organizations set up mail systems for high-value goods, especially confidential correspondence and bullion. In Britain, the post office packet service used small, fast, lightly armed ships to carry state papers to overseas destinations on a regular schedule. And then this service operated from Tudor times until 1823, when Admiralty, so that word again, assumed the responsibility for running the service. So here we're now more into about the shipping. So we start with mail sorting, you know, your local. This is what most people think of it. That's like the front face of the postal service. That's what you see. You receive a mail, you know, a letter in the mail, and all of us regular people, we might receive a pair of shoes, we might receive, you know, something by courier, but generally it's not a huge, we don't consider it to be such a big deal. They're just talking about the packet ships being targeted by for privateers and warships seeking prize money. So this is like now in the realms of like pirates and people trying to get ships, and the shipping trade now becomes a very big deal. In the 1850s, the post office moved to using contract carriers. So now we're having privatization. European states with overseas colonies also developed packet mail systems eventually. So now we know that packet can actually refer to cargo, mail, and or passengers, people. And this book is called The History of the British Post Office. And I just note here, so sailing packets and foreign connections. And it says here in 1827, I make that a little bit bigger. In 1827, all the packets sailing out of Falmouth were transferred to Admiralty. Okay? And that's all I really wanted out of that one. There's a full book on it there, but I found that that was the connection I needed to move on. And something I wanted to make a connection to now is the Postal Service and the Merchant Marine Navy. So here we see a number of different types of ships. We see container ships, something called Liberty ships, auxiliary steamship, and a clipper ship. So the growth of the U.S. Merchant Marine was being recognized on the Postal Service depictions here. So I started looking into the Merchant Navy, and so the Canadian Merchant Navy actually was created in a large-scale effort during World War II. 184 ships were involved in merchant shipping activity in the Canadian shipping industry. So merchants are the kinds of traders, I guess, that are now operating on the sea. Eventually, thousands of Canadians served aboard hundreds of Canadian merchant navy ships, notably Park ships, the Canadian equivalent of the American Liberty ship. Now, here we have the word liberty again. And just one of the posters from the Merchant Navy Service. The Merchant Service is silent too. Don't talk about cargo or ship sailings. It's all very hush-hush. We don't want to be revealing what we're shipping or when we're shipping it. So we went on and looked at what are the Liberty ships. So Liberty ships were a class of cargo ship. And they were a British concept designed and adopted by the United States for low-cost construction. All right, just can't move my page there. So it was a wartime industrial output. And so in 18 American shipyards, they built 2,710 Liberty ships between 1941 and 1945, which was an average of 3 ships every 2 days. Easily the largest number of ships ever produced to a single design. That's a lot of ships. Between 1941 and 1945, I thought most of the able-bodied people were actually fighting in the war. So, but no, they were building these Liberty ships. I shouldn't say no. Obviously, there was a lot of people fighting in the war because some of my family were in that. But it just seems like there was a lot of people also building ships. And again, these are not specifically warships. These are merchant marine ships, which is a different, you know, carries a totally different purpose. And I guess I was surprised that so much effort was being put into building merchant ships, merchant marine ships. And, you know, when it seems like all of the historical stories tell us that everyone had to get to war, everyone had to go to war, you know, it was like the biggest threat to mankind was this war. So to think that they were building 3 ships every single day for that entire period of time was quite an interesting surprise to me. And so just looking at the Merchant Marine Act of 1936, we see that it, you know, this is the American in 1936, so and it was just really establishing the ground, the foundation for what would become I guess a more imposing or dominating merchant marine internationally presence. United States Maritime Commission. And so obviously anything to do with the sea, anything to do with ships on the sea, there's always a maritime component. And I want to just note that anytime you see the word mer or mer, like in mermaid or mer, it's M-A-R, marine, it's always to do with the sea. And so we see here it was intended to formulate a merchant ship building program to design and build 500 modern merchant cargo ships. And this all ties back through what we've seen now. So we've started off with a post office, and you know, that letter delivery service that was initially kind of the king's special service, you know, the Royal Mail. They still call it the Royal Mail in England. But it was really like a secure, you know, you knew your piece of paper would get to where it was going, and it would be safe, and it would be untouched, and you would pay for that service. And so that was kind of the initial start, and then we saw it kind of coming through. Now we're actually talking about shipping, and we're talking about treaties, and we're talking about international treaties through these organizations that are involved in merchant deliveries. So merchant navy ships are now kind of, and that admiralty component. So it's kind of under the navy, but it's like a commercial delivery system. And I guess, you know, that's why this is why things are kind of coming together like this. So for whom they would have been, so those ships were intended to be chartered. And I'm just highlighting this part here because it says more economical freight services to their clients. The ships were also intended to serve as a reserve naval auxiliary force in the event of armed conflict, which was a duty the U.S. merchant fleet had often fulfilled throughout the years since the Revolutionary War. So, and I want to just point out that a lot of what the Navy was building was in the name of, well, when we go to war, we're going to need ships. But I think the more practical and regular use of these was commerce and trade. And so they started investing very heavily. They were investing very heavily in this this kind of asset. And we see here, you know, commercial operators who would use the ships in peacetime, but that the ships would be available for use by Navy. So again, they always have this caveat that, well, if we need it for, we better build them because we can use them. And then if we need them, we can put them into war. So it's like that justification for building all these ships. And here we go, like in the Long Range program grew in importance and in 1940 was accelerated to deliver more of the 500 planned ships sooner than the originally scheduled. So they're really, really building a ton of these ships now. And I'm just trying to give you the scale for how this was actually going. And they even had an emergency shipbuilding program, so 6,000 ships. And this is all going back to 1940s, you know. And it is, you know, the shipbuilding industry is huge, even where I live. And we just see this kind of like increasingly, incredibly huge shipping. And it is on this basis of merchant. So the merchants were trading over the seas, right? And this page here will just kind of underline the amounts of money or the amounts of like the quantities. So together they produced 2/3 of all Allied military equipment used in World War II. That includes, you know, 86,000 tanks, 2.5 million trucks, 500,000 jeeps, 286,000 warplanes, 8,800 naval vessels, and then 5,600 merchant ships, which I found, you know, understandably, if you're in a war, you're going to build warplanes, naval vessels, tanks, and all of that, but 5,600 merchant ships. So a merchant ship, merchant vessel, trading vessel, is a watercraft that transports cargo or carries passengers for hire. So that would be, you know, if someone wanted to send some passengers somewhere, they could pay a merchant vessel to take them there. And, you know, each vessel would have what they call a flag of convenience. And, you know, Panama, we know that canal area allows the ships to go, instead of going all the way around South America, they can just cut through from one ocean to the other. And it says here that they have more favorable maritime laws than other countries. And during wars, merchant ships may be used as auxiliaries, and they deliver military personnel and materials. So again, these are carrying people around. Commercial vessels engaged in commercial trade, carrying passengers for hire. Okay, so I think I'm making the point here that merchant ships were built to carry cargo and people, you know. We saw them called packet ships or packet boats before. And we just see this kind of theme that is continued. So and you know, just this kind of ongoing transportation. It comes under the transportation. And I think before I go to the next section here, I just want to read a verse from a couple of verses. So in Ezekiel 26, verse 12, Ezekiel prophesies against the king of Tyre, I believe it is, and they shall make a spoil of thy riches and make a prey of thy merchandise, and they shall break down thy walls and destroy thy pleasant houses, and they shall lay thy stones and thy timber and thy dust in the midst of the water. And say unto Tyrus, O thou that art situate in the entry of the sea, which are a merchant of the people for many isles, thus saith the Lord, O Tyrus, thou hast said, I am of perfect beauty. Thy borders are in the midst of the seas, thy builders have perfected thy beauty. They have made all thy shipboards of fir trees, they have taken cedars from Lebanon to make masts for thee. And then the inhabitants of Zidon and Arvad were thy mariners, thy wise men, O Tyrus, they were in thee, were thy pilots. The ancients of Gebal and the wise men thereof were in thee, thy caulkers, and all the ships of the sea with their mariners were in thee to occupy thy merchandise. And then continues to prophesy about this whole merchant trade that Tyre and all of these Tarshish trading their affairs, they were thy merchants, they traded the persons of men. See, so they were thy merchants, they traded the persons of men and vessels of brass in thy market. I believe this is talking about slave trading, human trafficking. And all of these cities, they're talking about the merchants and what they are trading. Obviously, there's a lot of trade and a lot of different things going on. I wanted to draw attention now to just kind of some of the historical hidden parts of history that I think we in this community have become aware of, and so I want to just talk about that a little bit. And here we can see that World War One was affected civilians on an unprecedented scale. Civilians became a military target with the economic impact of World War One, meaning that there were shortages of all produce, mostly important food supplies. During the war, 8 to 10 million soldiers were killed in battle and 22 million were injured. We know there was a time when openly the postal service was delivering babies in mailbags. And it says here that sending by mail was cheaper than a train ticket. And we can see as well, we know all about the orphan trains, most of us. If you haven't seen that, I encourage you to go look at it. From 1845 to 1929, an estimated 250,000 orphaned, abandoned, and homeless children were placed throughout the United States and Canada during the orphan train movement. When the orphan train movement began, it was estimated that 30,000 abandoned children were living on the streets of New York City. And that's from orphantraindepot.org. I think about some of the imagery that we get in movies, and this is The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. The children were taken to the countryside, and their parents aren't really mentioned in the movie too much, if at all. I don't remember that. And we see a lot of this imagery from around that World War One, World War Two eras. And then we also have Harry Potter, you know, being sent off on a train, and we know that he was kind of an orphan too. And so these themes crop up throughout when we start looking through different storylines that continually get used as if they're trying to tell us something. And so sending children around either by train, and they had to get to the train somehow from Europe, so let's say they took ships to North America or Australia or wherever they were going, and then they had to take a train from the port to whatever town they were going to be taken to. And this is something that's been on my radar for a while. As I started waking up, I started realizing symbology follows these people around, and a lot of nonprofit NGO type organizations seem to really hover around, you know, helping disadvantaged children in war-torn areas of the world. And Lumos being, looks like this kind of sun symbol, light symbol. And, you know, just kind of philanthropy, trusts, and foundations working with people in areas that are war-torn, you know. I mean, this is obviously a cause that's very close to the heart of these high-profile people who also write stories about children going on trains and things like that. Magic children. And we've got, where do we work? So Moldova, Colombia, Ukraine, Kenya. And you can look more into that. And taking children out of orphanages is another part of this project or this organization. Taking children out of orphanages and delivering them and to other people. Says here on an article, J.K. Rowling was approached to talk about her extensive charitable work with Ukraine, supporting families who have been affected by the current conflict in the region. And I bring this up because this was actually a prank, and it was so interesting. I can't get the footage of it anymore, the full footage. I did see it as soon as it happened, but it looks like it's been wiped off the internet. These pranksters pretended to be Zelensky, and there was J.K. Rowling on a call with them, and she thought she was doing business with Zelensky. And so you might find that somewhere. I wasn't able to find the actual full footage, but she did start talking at a certain point that she wanted to do business with Zelensky. I also found this interesting movie called The Post, which I've never actually heard of, but it's Meryl Streep and Tom Hanks. And just a really quick little clip. Risk everything for the truth.
Meaning,
well, we
could all go to prison.
I just found that clip really funny, that very short little, we could all go to prison. And it's called The Post, you know. So, anyway. Mothers of Misery. So this site here did an article on child abandonment in Russia. Over 10,000 of these each year to outlying villages for care. In 1882, there were all told 41,720 foundlings from Moscow living with 32,000 foster families scattered through 4,418 villages. So this is all kind of taking place around the time that the merchant navy and all of these ships are starting to really be built in great number. And then we had the Gilded Age. So we had this time of extreme wealth. And I guess if you were to, you know, take one side, which would be your merchants and your big shipping companies and all the land and all of the access to every single resource you could possibly find, it's no wonder they were dripping in money. And, you know, transferring people around the world. And here we just have, I believe this is in Northern Europe. This is a capture of people, women, who would end up somewhere, probably doing some kind of labor. And in North America, governments were separating native children from their families back in the 1800s. And in 1915, war babies, no definite information. So with the establishment of military camps all over the country, a very large proportion of illegitimate children must be the children of soldiers, I guess. Hellenic orphans taken abroad from 1812. So that was Greece. Thousands of orphans, and sometimes in one occurrence alone. The revolution in Greece, and the orphans were brought to America. And there's always really, really rich and helpful people that want to help orphans, and so we see this going on with all these great foundations that are involved in this kind of work. United States Merchant Marine. So again, the Merchant Marines primarily transport domestic and international cargo and passengers during peacetime and operate and maintain deep sea merchant ship, tugboats, etc. In 2022, the United States Merchant Fleet had 178 privately owned ocean-going self-propelled vessels of 1,000 gross registered tons. Nearly 800 American-owned ships are flagged in other nations. The North American shipping industry developed as colonies grew and trade with Europe increased. As early as the 16th century, Europeans were shipping horses, cattle, and hogs to America. In 2017, government-owned merchant vessels from the National Defense Reserve Fleet have supported emergency shipping requirements in 10 war and crisis. 10 wars and crisis. Now, again, I'm not saying they don't do deliveries of products and maybe things like that, but, you know, during the Haitian crisis in 1994, 15 ships were activated for Operation Uphold Democracy. How great is that? In 1995 and 96, four of the roll-on, roll-off ships were used to deliver military cargo as part of U.S. and U.K. support for NATO peacekeeping missions. It's just so honorable, right? And I know a lot of that is honorable, but I'm just saying. I think you get what I'm saying. The RRF was called upon to provide humanitarian assistance to Gulf Coast areas following Hurricane Katrina and Hurricane Rita. And I'm sure a lot of that was very helpful. No doubt about that. But I do see there's opportunity here for other kinds of trade and more nefarious things that may have, you know, taken place as well. In 2005, there were also 77 passenger ships. Of those American-flagged ships, 51 were foreign-owned. 794 American-owned ships are flagged in other nations. So this, you know, just the scale of this is so huge. And, you know, the fact that all of these countries have treaties with one another, they all, you know, and here we see George W. Bush delivering the commencement address at the United States Merchant Marine Academy. It's big business, you know. So when we look at the post offices of the old world, I think that the reason they were so big and ornate is because they knew the potential of, you know, taking control of the shipping, of the taking advantage of those treaties and of that entire system, you know, the revenue behind that. And again, I just want to keep driving the point home that these ships carry people. So these, you know, they say troop transport, which is something I guess you could do. Taking staff and their families. So 321 American citizens and 67 Chinese consular staffs and their families. Here you could actually take 20,000 troops. And again, I have family in, I have family who've been in the Navy, not the Merchant Navy, but the Navy. And so I don't, I'm not talking negatively about military people in general or any of our services, of course, but there is opportunity here within this merchant fleet, I think, that could be exploited. Let's put it that way. Okay. And so you have a merchant guild, which is an international commerce guild, and it's just been around for a long time. So this is a known entity, and I'm just going to change pages here. So something we need to talk about as well, and I'll go more into this thing in another video, but one of the big things that came about as part of the law of the sea, as part of this, sorry, maritime trade, the international commerce, merchant trade, was what we call the law of the sea. And it's referred to by the founding, the men who founded the government of the United States. And let me just go grab the picture here. So Thomas Jefferson in 1805 made a quote about the number of vessels and the number of seamen, and the mission of the Navy is to maintain, train, and equip combat-ready naval forces capable of winning wars, deterring aggression, and maintaining freedom of the seas. So freedom of the seas was always a big component of the original plan for the United States. And we know that Benjamin Franklin was a key figure in the colonial postal system. Oops, jumped up on me. And as I mentioned before, he was the first Postmaster General of the United States, right up until 1776, actually. And so he was appointed the first Postmaster General of the United States and was given authority over all post offices, and he held that position until November 1776. And so working hand in hand, these two individuals, or all of them, aimed to gain control of shipping, which also meant commerce and trade contracts and treaties and things like that. And Benjamin Franklin was very involved in the Paris Treaty of Paris. So I'm just going to move into some of this legal thing here, and first I'm going to put a little video on here. So one of my commenters told me about this scene, and I think it's really good. Watch the whole scene if you can. I'm just going to play a small part of it here that talks about the law, because I think the law is when, and this, you know, Al Pacino is depicting the devil here, and I believe that getting control of the law was exactly part of the plan throughout all of their activities, but specifically in relation to the law of the sea, believe it or not, and we'll get to that, but I want to just play this little clip here.
And why lawyers? Why the law?
Because the law, my boy, puts us into everything. It's the ultimate backstage pass. It's the new priesthood, baby. Did you know there are more students in law school than there are lawyers walking the earth? We're coming out! Guns blazing! The two of you, all of us, acquittal after acquittal after acquittal, until the stench of it reaches so high and far into heaven, it chokes the whole fucking lot of them.
In the Bible, you lose. We're destined to lose, Dad.
Well, consider the source, son. Besides, we're going to write our own book, chapter one. Right here, this altar, this moment.
Will you stop talking?
So we'll just stop that there. But as you look more into the Admiralty and the trade and the commerce and the contract law is huge. This component and kind of the origins of all of this is truly something that I believe Satan and his minions and the people that are working on his behalf have been aiming for. And I say that, you know, it's come through these kinds of channels. So the post office, the treaties, the independence movements, the rebellion, and, you know, now we can see that they really, really got hold of legal terms. And so the contract law is extremely convoluted, and it leverages language. And so we'll go into that in another video, but I want to go back to the George Washington, the apotheosis of George Washington, because it features this sort of Roman god figure who is Mercury, and he's carrying something called a caduceus. I think that's how you say it. And you'll see they're really actively right there. You know, he's got a money pouch in one hand, and it looks to me like they're writing trade contracts, because these are like deliveries. These people behind him are delivering boxes, and these people are writing contracts. So, and then there's a ship in the background, there's an anchor. And so this all ties together for me that these people are interested in doing deals with entities that give them this knowledge of contract language, how to manipulate a contract so that, you have the upper hand, and you know, all this kind of thing. And we will go into that more. Mercury, I believe, is credited with coinage, so money. And this whole staff thing here is not as much about healthcare as it is about alchemy and some of the more mystery religion kind of things. So the fact that it got onto things like ambulances and hospitals is obviously very strange, to say the least. Yeah, so just going back to Law of the Sea, we've got international maritime trade and the Treaty of Westphalia and freedom of the seas. So we saw Thomas Jefferson speaking about freedom of the seas. There is a difference between maritime law and common law. And one thing I will tell you is that they moved maritime law, so the law of the sea, they moved it onto land. And common law was always like the law of the land. Common law referred to, you know, a person's, you know, person living on the land. But what has happened through many political maneuvers and, you know, public consents is that maritime law ended up in every court of the world. And so, again, we'll talk about that separately. But I think there is a point to be made here, going back to Thomas Hobbes from a previous video that we had, the Leviathan symbology, you know, that beast rising from the sea. I think, you know, whether that's biblical or not, in this case, I do see this kind of connection between Leviathan, maritime law, admiralty law, and the law of the sea coming onto land. And even here you can see like the trident. So I want to just briefly, the Black's Law Dictionary has a lot of good information in it. If you're interested in kind of dissecting a little bit of the language, the legal language, but in here you will actually find information regarding maritime law. And so if I go to page 45, whoops, nope, that's not gonna find it. And we can just see here that a court exercising jurisdiction over maritime causes, both civil and criminal and maritime affairs, commerce and navigation. And this is very interesting because the United States, Canada, almost every town, if I go and look at the town hall in my own town, it's a corporation, okay? And the link here is that admiralty law is commerce law. And if your town or your country or your city is a corporation, which I can almost guarantee it is, then it is being, the jurisdiction is going to be admiralty law. And so unfortunately, being a citizen of a corporation is maybe not what you think it is. And I just encourage anyone to go and find, I use archive.org, but I encourage everyone to go and find the Black's Law Dictionary to to just read through some of the the definitions if you're interested in looking into this more. So marine, relating to the sea. Sorry, I went a little bit too far there. But I think the point here is just that I'm saying, go and read your laws, and go check your town hall, go check your city hall, and I can almost guarantee it's a corporation, meaning that it is being governed by admiralty law. And here's just some, you know, if you live in the United States, your flag will either have a gold fringe around it or it won't. And the gold fringe indicates marine admiralty law. So if that's up in a courtroom, if that's up in your town hall during town hall sessions or whatever that might be, then you know what's going on there. And that would be your regular flag. And obviously, I'm sure comments will give more information about that. You can find out whatever country you live in. This is for the United States, but this is just to underline the point that it is actually a federal corporation. U.S. Code Title 28. And I'll put a link to this in the video for anyone who wants to look into this more. There's a difference between the capital letters and when it's written without capitals, as down here. So they refer to different entities. And it is very good to read for your information. Also, when we look at this statue, we'll note that it is surrounded by water. And I've heard it said that the reason it is on this little island on the water is because it represents literally what Thomas Jefferson spoke about, which was freedom of the seas. Freedom to ship, freedom to trade on the sea. And here's the trick. If all of your court systems and all of your legal system is based on the law of the sea, then technically trading on land is trading on the sea, because all of the jurisdiction is naval jurisdiction. So I think that's part of the big liberty plan. This was part of the big liberty plan. Also, the statue at the Chicago World's Fair is on the water as well. Indicates something very similar to me, that it just, it's as if this being came through the Royal Arch right on the water. And just going back in history a little bit, so the Phoenician civilization were very much a merchant trading civilization. They traded on the sea, and they held a lot of probably the biggest pull or influence in that area. Just some of their shipping, and this was kind of the area that they had expertise in all these ports. So I think the roots of all of this is very much Phoenician, and I believe that a lot of the royal bloodlines have actually links to these Phoenician traders, merchants, who were also known as Canaanites and did not treat their children very well. And just bringing into the picture as well, the pirate with the one eye symbolism, indicating to me that these merchant traders, whether you want to dress them up like pirates or whatever you want to dress them up as, they do not serve the true God. And I think that has been used extensively in movies to show us almost like that revealing method, who they are and what they do. And something just to finish up here that I wanted to talk about was, you know, there was always a question mark for me over the Quakers that came from Europe, and it was never very clear to me who are the Quakers, what do they believe, because it, you know, I always thought they were kind of Christians, but actually they were not considered to be Christians, and I found that they helped thousands of people immigrate over to the United States. And so that's just an interesting point to make there. I don't know what else to say about that, actually, but and then a last thing about people being shipped about. So just some numbers here. They used a lot of hospital prison ships. This is going back to the 1700s. You know, 1,000 prisoners total on all ships was 2,000. And then there's lists and lists and lists of names that you can go through. I guess these are for finding names of people that you may have a connection to. But yeah, prison and hospital ships, name, capacity, first year of use. It just seems like a lot of people were on these prison hospital ships. And Society of Old Brooklynites compiled this list in 1888. And then we also have some, if you want to go look at this, there's Gen I, Great Migration passengers on these ships. And this is going back to the 1600s, so, you know, and I understand, you know, if you're going to move hundreds of people, you are going to need a ship, right? So that part of it makes logical sense, but it's just the point that there's a lot of ships that were transferring people all over the world. You know, here we have Bacon, Baron, George, Mason, the children, maidservant, you know, and all these people. And I get that, you know, this migration happened and it just seemed so normal back a few years ago, when I never used to think about what the Postal Service did and why it existed. But now, obviously, we know a lot more. So just to round up this session, I think there's a lot to be revealed when it comes to the Postal Service, and I think it's just much bigger than any of us probably realized. I certainly didn't realize it was so huge, and I knew a lot of the pieces separately, but I didn't until now really put it all together. So I guess some startling realizations is that the Merchant Navy ships a lot of people around, and I noticed that as I was going through it all, there was a lot of, you know, war relief that they were taking people out of by the thousands, you know, so they would go to Korea and, oh no, there's a war going on there, so we need to get people out. So let's take 20,000 people out of Korea, or, and I do mean big numbers of people. And so this kind of, when we talk about the generation of war and how war can actually generate economy and can boost economy, I think, yeah, now that actually makes sense to me. If, you know, without saying too specifically, but like if you're trading in human cargo and you know, you're bringing people to places and there's a lot of money changing hands. And if you cause those wars, then you can certainly go and reap these financial economic benefits. So I guess that's all I had for today. It was a lot, and I thank you for staying with me. And I just, I will take that Admiralty Law piece into another video. It is really, you know, for those of us who really want to get into the weeds like that, and I encourage everyone to actually look into it because it will affect every single one of us. I don't know what the end result is in terms of this short season. I don't know how that kind of wraps up the bigger problems that we have. Like, I don't know how that kind of, but we'll get into that. So thank you so much. I really appreciate you being here again. I'm having a lot of fun. I hope you are too. And kind of a weird fun because some of this content isn't actually very nice, but we know that Jesus is in charge. He is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And so for this short season, understanding the people behind it, their methods, and what they're trying to get out of it, I think is just can be very helpful to us in seeing through the lies and hopefully continuing working for the kingdom and warning people of what's going on if we can. So thank you, and I'll see you next time. Take care. Bye-bye.